Hi, today we will be making this cute little battery powered 2D sound visualizer. It can display various animations that just looks mesmerizing, and the sound reactive feature is a cherry on the top. It is portable and the wood finish makes it look classy too. Because the firmware used in it is WLED, it can easily be controlled over Wi-Fi through browser or its own app. Let's dive into the details of building it and I'll show you the ups and downs I faced on the way. And before we do, let me tell you, I have never changed my plans this much on any of my projects. At one point, I even thought the project was overambitious and I was about to give up. More on that later. The star of this project is 8x8 WS2812B LED matrix. Yeah, I hear you, I should not use red wires for both VCC and ground, but see, I color the ground wire black with a marker. That should work, right? The brain of this project is ESP32. We cannot use ESP8266 because the WLED firmware supports 2D animations for ESP32 only. For audio sensing, we will use this INMP441 sensor. It is a digital output sensor, but it is very different from those comparator-based ones. The microphone used in this is a MEMS device. It is a high-performance, low-power, omnidirectional mic. Along with this mic, INMP441 has signal conditioning, an analog-to-digital converter, anti-aliasing filters, power management, and an industry-standard 24-bit I2S interface. To learn more about this and to learn how to test it, you can check out the video description. I will leave some links there that has all the information required. First, we will have to upload the firmware on ESP32. Upload it the same way we did in my previous sound reactive floor lamp project. Just with one change. You will have to upload two firmware this time. One is the bootloader and another one is the actual firmware. All these steps can be found in the WLED webpage. After that, I connected everything up in the breadboard to test it out. Connection diagram can be found in the video description. Apply 5 volts and if the first 30 LEDs light up in orange, we are good to go. Follow the procedure to connect it to your home network and find its IP address. Go to that IP address and test it out. If you have connected everything correctly, it should work. No need to change any settings. Once you have tested it out, change the number of LEDs to 64 in the LED preferences setting. By the way, you can use this method to remove any IC or any module which has a lot of pins from the breadboard. There's a pretty good chance of damaging the pins if you don't do it the right way. I wanted to find out the maximum current this panel can draw, which will be white color at full brightness. At 50% brightness, it reached to drawing around 1.2 amps, which soon collapsed and the LEDs went back to orange, started acting randomly, and the ESP32 also stopped taking inputs. I thought my power supply was not enough, which was weird as it was rated for 3 amps. So I connected another one with 10 amps rating and the same thing happened. Then I had to change my setup and it is stable this time. Turns out my multimeter was faulty. At 25% brightness, it draws around 1.25 amps, 1.8 amps at 50% brightness and 2.3 amps at 100% brightness. Anyway, this was just a test. It is strongly advised to never run this LED matrix on 100% brightness on any color. The panel gets heated up pretty fast and it can shorten the lifetime of the LEDs or even permanently destroy the panel. For powering the whole thing, I am using this lithium-ion battery with 2500 mAh of capacity. For charging the battery, I'll be using this TP4056 charger. You will notice that the charging module doesn't have the protection circuit which we strongly need. For the enclosure, we will use this teak wood which has a width of 28mm and depth of 14mm. Before choosing the wood piece though, make sure it is extremely flat. If it is not, it can make our life much harder. I marked length of 293mm and 265mm on the wood block. I used a very fine curve cutting blade to get precise cuts and cut them out. Always keep 2-3mm of room for errors. You can always reduce the extra wood, but you cannot increase it. Be double sure of the dimensions, otherwise all our hard work can go to waste in no time. I will be using two of these 90 degree clamps to hold two wood pieces together. Then to further attach the wood pieces to each other, I will use glue. The height at which these clamps will be attached is equal to the height of the LED panel so that when the clamps are attached, the LED panel can sit on top of it. Also, we will have to make cutout for the battery charger on the 65mm wood piece. But before doing all that, make sure the wood surfaces are flat. Mine were not, so I will file them first. Using a wood file, I made the wood pieces exactly equal in length. To hold the clamps, screw like this will be used. Make sure the length of the screws doesn't cross the depth of the wood pieces. Also, the clamp should be exactly 90 degrees. If not, take measures to make it 90 degrees. Use the LED panel as template to mark the place for screws. Using a masking tape as guide, drill holes on the marked places just enough to accommodate the screws. After one hole is drilled, fix the clamp there and make marking for second screw. This ensures that there is no chance for error. Mark this spot for charging module. Using a mix of tools like hacksaw, wood file, fine file, etc., make the cutout. Be patient as it can take time. It took me a total of 2 hours just to get this thing right. As it is battery powered, we will need a switch to turn the whole circuit on and off. I made markings and cut it out using a combination of drill, jigsaw and curve cutting blade. Also a file and some patience. I cannot stress enough how handy this tiny file was for all the cutouts. Now as the depth of the wood is a bit much, a small hole cannot guarantee that the sound will raise the sensor efficiently. We will need to bring the sensor closer to the environment. For that, we need another cutout. Make a pilot hole first, it will help in guiding the bigger drill bit. I tested if the sensor fits in 16mm hole and it does. I tried to fit it in 12mm hole as well, but it didn't fit there. So 16mm it is. I made the hole on the original wood base after this. A quick tip. Save this wood powder as it can be used to fill small holes and gaps later. Last thing we need is a hole for a blue LED that will tell us when the battery is full. This small LED does the job perfectly and the blue light seems to travel through the wood as well. So no need to take it any closer. Now you know what time it is. It's time for sanding. I started sanding all the 4 pieces with a 180 grit sandpaper. The idea of sanding is to remove the residues that might have been settled on the wood over time, like these paint spots, so that the wood can absorb the polish we are about to do after this. Use something like a newspaper or a plastic sheet to collect the sanded away wood particles. You can clearly see the difference before and after sanding. It removed even the marker spots that I made. Once all the 4 pieces are sanded, we can start polishing them with this beeswax and a lint-free cloth. Take a generous amount on the cloth and start rubbing it on all the 6 sides of the pieces. Take your time with this. The more patiently you'll do it, the better it will look. After first coat, I waited half an hour and applied second coat and then let it dry overnight. They look like this after they are dry. This is the first time I am polishing a wood and this is not the best finish I have ever seen. But still, it looks better than before. Should have applied an oil finish first though. Moving on. I just realized I made a mistake here. This hole for clamp should be in the back. I will drill it through for now and we can cover it up later. Okay, so from here on, I will be forced to change my plan for I don't know how many times. Let's see. I test the clamps and try to fit the LED panel. There is a slight dimension mismatch as you can see, which is making the enclosure protrude longer on one side. I had accounted for the dimension of the battery with its holder, thinking it could possibly fit diagonally, and if not, I can shorten the holder to fit it diagonally. But fate has it that after doing so, we won't have enough space for all the electronics. I desoldered the blue LED and soldered red and black wires for anode and cathode of the LED on the charging module. Test it out on an LED by disconnecting the battery from charging module and applying power to it. Using super glue, I fixed the charging module. Just make sure that it is flat, otherwise we can have trouble while completing the enclosure. Change of plans, I dropped the idea of using clamps to save space and use super glue instead to attach all the 4 wood pieces together. Use the LED panel as template and apply a drop of glue to every place you can. Fix the panel temporarily using some drops of hot glue. Change of plans again. I had to drop the battery holder eventually to make space for other electronics, and since I don't have a spot welder, I had to use an old Selvage 2200mAh battery with attached nickel strips. I soldered the protection circuit to the nickel strips. The positive output from protection circuit is intercepted by the switch and connects to XL6009 boost converter to convert battery voltage to 5V. As it must handle a lot of amps, it will get very hot. I will use a small heatsink to dissipate the heat. The LED strip connects to ESP32 using these headers. I have also soldered headers to microphone module. But the ESP32 will not fit here if we keep the microphone module in the hole we made. So instead, change of plans, we will have to put it in the back. I also added power sharing circuit below the ESP32 to be able to use it while charging as well. This is the power connector connected to output of boost converter, and purple wire will be connected to 5V input for the load sharing circuit. The ESP32 can fit in snugly besides the battery. As the 5V input is directly connected to the load sharing circuit, whenever we are charging the battery, the whole circuit will turn on. We can prevent it by intercepting the 5V input using the same switch as it is our DPDT switch. Now circuit will only turn on when the switch is on, even while battery is charging. As the 5V input pin is hidden, I utilized pin 4 of TP4056IC, which is connected to 5V input, to connect anode of LED and load sharing input pin. Once done, everything can fit into its place like a puzzle piece. This project made me think if it was overambitious. But then again, I was somehow able to do it. So I guess there's no thing called overambitious. It's just a limit set by people's mind which ambitious people try to overcome. Enjoy the show. I couldn't decide on what to use for the front and back panel. I was thinking to use this milky white acrylic sheet for the front. Help me decide in the comment section below. Don't forget to like and subscribe. Till next time.